Yeah,
enjoy.
Thank you for the introduction. Actually, because when you are submitting the talks, it's a little bit early, so at the beginning of the year, you don't know what's actually coming now. So I will not talk about something which might come in the next years. I will tell you today what comes out next week in Apache Lucene 9.7. So we have some great improvements there, also ready to be used for Elasticsearch, Solr, and all those stuff. So the abstract text was a little bit changed. So I'm starting first with my background. So I'm one of the Lucene committers since very, very long time. I'm PMC member of Apache Lucene and also Solr, but my focus is mainly on Apache Lucene. Then I'm also doing a lot of Elasticsearch and OpenSearch. I'm helping people with my company to set up Elasticsearch, Solr, and all that stuff. Often I'm doing very, very special stuff like writing query parsers and all that, which is a little bit more low level. I'm also working at the University of Bremen and I'm maintaining a long-term archival database for scientific data called Pangea. So when planning the talk, I figured out that this year somehow is the 25 years of birthday of Lucene somehow, because in 1998, Doug Cutting released the first version on SourceForge. At that time, unfortunately, I was not able to figure out the exact date because unfortunately, the CVS repositories by SourceForge were completely canceled and you cannot, I think you can download them, but that was too much work to do that. So I don't know the exact date. The only thing that I know is that it's now 22 years at the Apache Software Foundation. So at the moment, we have 33 PMC members, 98 committers, a lot of developers on the list, and already many, many forks. In the new repository, so the old repository reaching back to 2001 has 2.7 forks. So that's just the statistics to make the original talk, which I was planning to have that ready. And now I'm coming back to some short features which we had in the past, which lead to what we have now and what would be released next week. So actually, it will also show a little bit that there's steady evolution in Lucene. It's all the time going on. There's new features coming. Also, it's already 25 years old, which is really interesting for an open source project because most of them are stopping to have evolution much earlier. So we talked about that already. Then in 2011, which is already 10 years later, we were at version 3.1. I'm just mentioning it here because at that point there was great restructuring in the community because Lucene and Solr, which is a search engine server on top of Lucene, was released. So there was a merge, and because of that, Lucene got a lot new features like those token streams and everything. So a little bit later, Lucene Solr 4.0 came out, which a completely new API for the postings list, and everything was now this four-dimensional posting list API. There was also a lot of talks already on Berlin Buzzwords about finite state automatons and transducers. So that was version 4, still great, and it's already now 11 years since the beginning, then it got to the Apache Software Foundation. Then another great thing which I am also involved with was in Lucene 6, that we have numerical queries since that time with multiple dimensions and Java 9 support. And then one interesting thing is in Lucene 8, so you see here the releases coming more often. It's like Firefox now, I have no idea. So Lucene 8 got the Blockmax weekend. And I'm telling that because the interesting thing here is actually what was implemented by Adrian at that time was coming very, I think was invented already in the 90s, how to skip over some blocks in the in the posting list to figure out which documents are not relevant at all and skip over them. So the idea was, and actually in 2012 we had a talk here at Berlin Buzzwords by Stefan Pohl from Nokia, and he proposed it for the first time to implement that in Lucene, but it then took six or seven years till it was released, because there was multiple iterations in creating it, because we wanted to have it flexible for the scoring model, so it should not be fixed to BM25 or whatever. So the idea here was, it was a very, very long time. And I'm telling that, so actually, we get something which is developed for a very long time, and then suddenly it appears in Lucene, and we can use it. Actually, then only 2 years later, Lucene 9.0 came out, and now I'm coming to that part which I'm talking about, and you have heard about it already yesterday, all the time, everybody's talking about it. So actually, we got vector support in Lucene, and that's the interesting thing. And interestingly here, the paper about that HNSW vectors was coming out in 2016, and actually the implementation was already ready in 2019. So we had the HNSW graph available. Actually at that point, the H was not really implemented, so it was only that part. It came a little bit later. We only have four of those levels. If you wanted, if you have listened to the talk by Alessandro yesterday, he explained it very, very clear how that worked. And actually, it was merged in December 2020 and released shortly after in 21. So actually, here we had a very, very short release cycle, but the problem here is now that we have now some problems in maintaining that, because actually this type of implementation for the graph doesn't really fit well with how the Lucene scorers and everything works. So basically, if you are executing a query and want to filter the results, this is also the reason why it came a little bit later, that you can do a combined search with filters in Lucene together with vector search. So basically, it's still something which doesn't really fit together well. So it could be that this implementation will also be replaced. But in the meantime, we have to live with that implementation, which is not the ideal case for an inverted index like Lucene. So the downsides of that is you have to do many, many vector similarity calculations during the indexing of that graph. So basically, every incoming vector has to be figured out where in the graph it needs to be. So what you need is, you have to compare a lot of vector similarities. There are actually three in Lucene implemented. There's a dot product, cosine similarity, and this square distance, which is just adding up the differences. So basically, whenever you index something, you have to compare it to most of those vectors. As said before, we have no Boolean logic at query time, so it's not easy to combine that together with filters. And also, there's currently no real support for combining the scores between the Lucene, the normal BM25 score and the vector score. There are possibilities now coming in the new version, so I can tell you, I don't want to talk about that today, but we will also have function query support in the next version. So also Solar users will be happy that they can create the dot product of the vector and at the same time multiply it with their score. But the other downside of that is that it often does not use the HNSW index, so it just is a scan through all the vectors, which is one possibility. And another thing is, because of the segment structure of Lucene, whenever you merge two segments, you have to rebuild the whole graph of that. And when doing that, you have to multiply every vector with every other vector in those segments, more or less. And this is a major approach. And because of that, the idea now, how can we improve that vector distance calculation in the new version of Lucene that will come out next week? So how to speed that up? So actually, with the next version, which is coming out next week, we will have native SIMD vector support for all JVMs for 20 and 21. So this only works if you're running Lucene, Solr, or Elasticsearch with Java 20 at least, or Java 21. It won't work with any version before. So you will see here, it's really a good idea to update in that case. So the problem, what we really want to do is how can we improve that vector distance? So basically, as I said before, we have the dot product, the cosine, and the Euclidean distance. And actually, what was done currently in Lucene, we are just hoping that the hotspot optimizer is somehow taking that for loop. So basically, I can show you the dot product here. It's very, very easy. So basically, we are just summing up over the product of all components of the vector. And the question is, we are hoping that this is optimized by the hotspot analyzer. Does anybody know why it does not work for that loop? It does not work. So it won't vectorize it. The hotspot doesn't do anything. Yeah, the reason is quite easy. The problem is here we are summing up on this result vector here. So every calculation depends on the result that was there before. The problem is we have float vectors here. And actually, in the mathematical sense, the addition is cumulative. So you can switch off the order of the additions. But actually, because we are using floats here, this is not the case. If we change the order of the addition, the result will be different. And due to the rules that an optimization is not allowed to change the result, there's no optimization going on. Actually, the problem here is it doesn't work. You can test that out. You can try to write a benchmark and get out the stack, those compilation logs. It won't really work in Java. So, and because of that, with Java already 14, 15, 16, something around that, they have something available to make vectorize that part of a dot product to use the features of your CPU, which means every CPU core can execute multiple vector multiplications in parallel. So every core can do that. That's one thing. And the second thing is it can do that with many, many dimensions already. It depends if your CPU has AVX 256. So it can already fit a lot of float vectors in this 256 bits and can multiply them to each other. And then it can do that in parallel. On most CPUs, it's four parallel processing units that can do that. So actually, you will see here, I think we can increase the speed of that by more than a factor of four sometimes, depending on the hardware that you have. So, but unfortunately, that is not working with the hotspot optimizer, so we need something else, and that is Project Panama. If you were there last year, you remember about my talk about memory map directory. So actually, this is mostly to interconnect Java with the operating system, so it's possible to do some lower-level implementations in Java. Actually, the first thing is, I talked about that yesterday, it's memory map directory. You can also call functions from the libc or whatever, but one of the third thing is the Panama Vector API, and that's the really interesting thing used here. So this will come in the next version. Very, very short. I don't want to go into the details because now you see what you're all waiting for, the very, very horrible code. So this simple Scala loop here, if you write that with the Project Panama, it looks like this. actually, the idea here, what we are doing is we want to tell the CPU, divide everything into four parts. So we are splitting the whole vector into four parts. And for each of those four parts, we are multiplying those components and create a new vector as an accumulation result. And we split it into four parts so it can be executed in parallel. We don't have any threads here. So it's automatically doing that. And at the end, we are just summing up and do the aggregation together. So basically, we are unrolling all that loop to give the CPU, so the hotspot optimizer knows how to transform that to assembly instructions. So basically, that's what's happening here. I don't want to go into the details. The important thing is what you see here on the bottom. You see this tail here. So it's very important that your length of your dimensions, so the vector length, should be something like a multiply of that bit size of the CPU. So actually, I can tell you already, make your vectors multiples of 64 dimensions. So something like 93 dimensions is a very, very bad idea, because actually it's then slower than 128 dimensions at the end. So that's one thing. If you are creating your models, use multiplies of 64 to get use of the best CPUs available from Intel at the moment, which can do 512 bits in one go. So the problem now, how to compile that with Java 11, that's the last thing. So actually, the problem is we have a version for Java 19, for the memory map directory. We have a version for Java 20. We have a version for Java 21, because this is all an API which is not yet stable in the JDK. So it changes with every release, and it's not possible to execute the code on a later Java version. So actually, in the Lucene code, we need to have everything, the source code of that that we have seen before in different directories, and we want to compile that. Unfortunately, the Lucene people don't want to download three or four different JDKs, and also Gradle is not able to do that if you want to do early release testing. So actually, what we are doing here, we are tricking a little bit the JDK, and we have extracted that API to char files, which we are shipping in our source directory. And what we are doing is we are simply compiling against char files for Java 19. This is only the API for Java 19. And actually, it's a char file generated out of So whenever you update it, you have to extract the source code, or everything that is bytecode, which would be GPL, is removed. So we only let this method signatures there, and then we compile against those. And basically, it looks like that. So the interesting thing is we are just tricking the compiler to take our char file and patch it into the Java base module. So you see here, and after that, we can simply compile with the Java 11 compiler the whole code, and can ship it in the multi-release char with Apache Lucene. So basically how it works, just very, very quick, I have 3 more minutes about the results. So actually, this is the point where the indexing, the plain text gigabytes per hour went up from 225 gigabytes to, so it's something like 12-15%, I don't remember. Search queries here also get an even bigger spike. Sorry for that other thing, there was some bug which suddenly caused everything to get slower. That was on the Lucene, and in Elasticsearch, thanks to Chris, who is now a PMC member since today. Also, here we had something, he said indexing throughput in Elasticsearch for vectors raised by 30%. Interesting is also the merge time, because you know every vector has to be multiplied because everything was even 40% faster. And the script score query latency improved by 40%, so you can see here some very nice things here. How to use it? So for the MMAP directory from last year, just use Java 19, 20, or 21. That works. But for the new feature, Java 20 and 21, which is an incubating feature in the JDK, you have to pass add module JDK incubator.vector to your Java command line, and then it will use it automatically in Lucene. So Elasticsearch already implemented that. Next version of Elasticsearch will enable that module for you if you are running with that correct version. And I hope Sola, when it upgrades Lucene, will also do the same. So the important thing is the right one is not opt-in, the left one is opt-in. You have to explicitly say, I want to have that. So now it's 1 minute.
Thanks, Uwe, for this really packed talk.
Packed, yeah, yeah.
So we have time for one or two questions. Does anybody have a question on this great topic? Then... 1, 2, 3. Then, oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. So many questions.
I've got one question.
Thank you, Uwe, for the nice talk. I was just wondering the point where you were explaining the dot product. You divided the vector in four. Is because it's one byte, and you were talking about like the dot product between float element.
Yeah.
So that's the reason there were four lines.
No, the four lanes is basically because all current CPUs are using that. You could also implement more lanes, but this is just more work and code gets bigger. But the benchmarks we were doing just said, okay, it's enough to unroll that loop into four parts and then we are just dividing it. So basically, you're trying to divide it into four parts, because that's what can be done in parallel, and the rest we are just splitting based on the length of the processing unit. So if it's 256 bits, that's a constant that you can query from the JVM, which is the supported length of those vectors, and then you can use that in your for loop. So it's basically we're splitting first in four, and then we are using the rest with splitting into a loop using the number or exactly to calculate the dot product for the bit size. And at the end, very low, if you have something like power of two dimension lengths, we are just calculating the rest of the calculation in the conventional way by doing it Scala. So actually, if you have something like 100 dimensions, it's actually slower than 128 dimensions. Because at the end, you have something, I think, with current CPUs, it's you still need to do additional multiplications at the end just to get exactly those limits.
Thank you.
Does it explain it somehow? But we can also talk about that a little bit later.
All right, great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, audience.